that he's with us this evening. So Michael's lecture will take place for about an hour. There'll also be some questions afterwards. I hope there. I've also been told that thanks to Harvey's and Lewis, we have some beer left over. So if you'd like a glass of Harvey's beer at the end of the lecture, please go through the cafe. So thank you for coming, and thank you, Michael.
Right, well, thank you for coming. I'm hugely impressed by the turnout at 6 p.m. I can't actually see any of you at the moment, by the way, so I'll just have to imagine you, but I did see you earlier. Now, the inspiration for the first part of this talk, came from a somewhat unexpected source. My kids were watching Wallace and Gromit in The Curse of the Were-Rabbit, and I was whiling away the time looking up negative internet movie database reviews, as one does, and I came across this one. By Bacon Balls 1969 from Nottinghamshire, England, where amongst complaining that this movie was not my kind of humour at all, maybe it has something to do with the fact that I have an extreme phobia of rabbits, I'm petrified of the things, and a giant one out on the loose is the stuff of nightmares for me, no matter how cute it looked. I also noticed that he said, what really cheesed me off was that on many occasions you could see fingerprints in the clay characters, especially on Gromit, and I thought that that made it look very amateur. You'd have thought that the filmmakers would have worn rubber gloves to avoid such a thing happening. And as soon as I read that, I immediately thought of one of the most powerful sequences in all of Jan Švankmajer's films, namely the middle section of his 1982 masterpiece, Dimensions of Dialogue. Now, clearly, you can see the animator's finger marks. Equally clearly, far from being a drawback, this is one of the main things that gives the sequence such power. You can literally see invisible hands shaping and moulding the clay and kneading it into new forms, just as the figures themselves are reshaping each other. You could do something similar, I dare say, with computer-animated figures, but you'd lose the tactile impact. And as we shall see, the tactile element is one of the most crucial aspects of Jan Švankmajer's art. And so is, quite literally, being able to see the joins. In this sequence from his first feature, Alice, the hapless protagonist, who has for various reasons become her own doll, is surrounded by creatures whose strangeness is accentuated by the fact that we can see exactly how they've been created from actual animal and bird skeletons. This opening sequence from Punch and Judy, Švankmajer is only too happy to give us a peek behind the scenes at the mechanism. Similarly, in this sequence from his second feature, Faust, he blithely combines both puppet and human performers.
Jester, that's enough. You've won. Show her a little mercy, please.
Bad looking.
You can see how the thunder's done. And here we have the puppet.
And while he's in this state, I'll run. Why wait?
breaking free of his strings, while the devil runs out into an ordinary crowded street. I worked on the first UK release of Faust, and I remember when it opened, quite a few people had trouble processing all this, but puppetry is also a core ingredient in Schwenkmeyer's work, as is the juxtaposition of wildly incongruous material. A huge amount of Schwenkmeyer's work is essentially collage-based, whether expressed through the more conventional form of cut-out images glued onto paper, or the way he utilises existing objects as building blocks to construct the images in his films, which are then edited in such a way as to find unexpected analogies between outwardly dissimilar materials. This is how Schwenkmeyer himself puts his philosophy. Analogy is crucial to understanding his work, and he's discussed the subject a great many times, and this sums up his views. Our rationalist civilization is based on an identical principle of thought. Analogy is characteristic for primitive cultures and, of course, for small children, because through analogy, they can broaden their horizon of knowledge, and only thanks to this can they form their concept of the world, which has been typical of man since time immemorial. Man wants, always and under any circumstances, to know the answers to all questions, to live in a concept. Through analogy, a child adds other things and objects to what it already knows, i.e. what it can name, which are similar to each other by some element of its existence. And so, on a certain level of knowledge, they are put into one analogical bag: thunder, drum, cannon, or penis, worm, snake, fish. This knowledge, of course, does not disappear with the rationalization of one's later years. It is just pushed into the subconscious from where it operates further, forged into a symbol or poetic image. And that statement also makes it clear that one of the highest compliments Schwenkmeyer can pay is infantile. Like Picasso, he envies the child's ability to think out of the box because the box has yet to be constructed. And so the child is not only free to experiment, but is actively encouraged to do so. And one of the reasons Schwenkmeyer consistently refuses to supply ready-made interpretations of his work is because he wants us to draw our own analogies, to throw our own perception and experience into the mix. Now, collage in some form has been around for hundreds of years, but it was in the early 20th century that the medium really flourished, largely thanks to the Cubists in the 1910s onwards, it's Picasso, and later and more intensively, the Surrealists in the 1920s. And by the middle of that same decade, Sergei Eisenstein, Vsevolod Pudovkin, and other Soviet pioneers were developing and refining their approach to editing film along principles very similar to those practiced by collage artists, in that they sought to combine often wildly disparate images to create specific effects. And of course, all these had a distinguished predecessor in the form of Italian mannerist painter Giuseppe Arcimboldo, this is his famous self-portrait, whose human heads constructed from fish, books, and many, many other things, are clearly constructed according to the principles of collage, even though the medium is oil on canvas. Arcimboldo was the court painter to the eccentric Prague-based Bohemian emperor Rudolf II, who was around in at the turn of the 16th, 17th centuries. And Schwenkmeyer has confessed on many occasions that he is absolutely obsessed with his work. As he puts it, "What is it? What attracts me so irresistibly to Giuseppe Arcimboldo's method that sometimes I am not even shy of imitation, which I otherwise despise? What sort of force is it which always deafens all rational arguments against it? Is it the evocative force of mannerist Prague to which someone who has lived there all his life succumbs with intense pleasure? Is it the message of Rudolf II himself, secretly crossing the centuries? Or is it a sublimation of memories of childhood masturbation, which psychoanalysts say later manifests itself as a passion for collecting, the accumulation of objects, which is so particular to Arcimboldo's method? Did Arcimboldo ever masturbate in childhood? We shall obviously never know." Surrealist collage, Soviet montage, and Arcimboldo's paintings were both formative and continuing influences on Jan Schwenkmeyer, and it comes as little surprise that by the late 60s, when his stylistic approach and thematic preoccupations had become well established, that he found common cause with the Czechoslovak Surrealist group. After many discussions with its ideological guru, Vratislav Effenberger, Schwenkmayr and his wife Eva, who was also a distinguished surrealist painter in her own right, formally joined in 1970, and he remains an active member to this day. 2 years later, in 1972, he began his most ambitious collage project, the so-called Schwenkmayr's Builder Lexicon, or Schwenkmayr Encyclopedia. As he put it, "I wanted to create an encyclopedia of a kind of alternative world. I started mapping its fictitious flora and fauna. I thought up an equivalent technology and architecture, history and cartography. I took old lexicons, price catalogues and atlases and started cutting them up and sticking them together. After 2 years of work, the project was left as a torso because I came to realise that it would take me all my life."
that he's with us this evening. So Michael's lecture will take place for about an hour. There'll also be some questions afterwards. I hope there. I've also been told that thanks to Harvey's and Lewis, we have some beer left over. So if you'd like a glass of Harvey's beer at the end of the lecture, please go through the cafe. So thank you for coming, and thank you, Michael.
Right, well, thank you for coming. I'm hugely impressed by the turnout at 6 p.m. I can't actually see any of you at the moment, by the way, so I'll just have to imagine you, but I did see you earlier. Now, the inspiration for the first part of this talk, came from a somewhat unexpected source. My kids were watching Wallace and Gromit in The Curse of the Were-Rabbit, and I was whiling away the time looking up negative internet movie database reviews, as one does, and I came across this one. By Bacon Balls 1969 from Nottinghamshire, England, where amongst complaining that this movie was not my kind of humour at all, maybe it has something to do with the fact that I have an extreme phobia of rabbits, I'm petrified of the things, and a giant one out on the loose is the stuff of nightmares for me, no matter how cute it looked. I also noticed that he said, what really cheesed me off was that on many occasions you could see fingerprints in the clay characters, especially on Gromit. And I thought that that made it look very amateur. You'd have thought that the filmmakers would have worn rubber gloves to avoid such a thing happening. And as soon as I read that, I immediately thought of one of the most powerful sequences in all of Jan Švankmajer's films, namely the middle section of his 1982 masterpiece, Dimensions of Dialogue. Now, clearly, you can see the animator's finger marks. Equally clearly, far from being a drawback, this is one of the main things that gives the sequence such power. You can literally see invisible hands shaping and moulding the clay and kneading it into new forms, just as the figures themselves are reshaping each other. You could do something similar, I dare say, with computer-animated figures, but you'd lose the tactile impact. And as we shall see, the tactile element is one of the most crucial aspects of Jan Švankmajer's art. And so is, quite literally, being able to see the joins. In this sequence from his first feature, Alice, the hapless protagonist, who has for various reasons become her own doll, is surrounded by creatures whose strangeness is accentuated by the fact that we can see exactly how they've been created from actual animal and bird skeletons. In this opening sequence from Punch and Judy, Švankmajer is only too happy to give us a peek behind the scenes at the mechanism. Similarly, in this sequence from his second feature, Faust, he blithely combines both puppet and human performers.
Jester, that's enough! You won! Show a little mercy, please!
Badly okay!
You see how the thunder's done? And here we have the puppets.
And while he's in this state, I'll run! Why wait?
breaking free of his strings, while the devil runs out into an ordinary Prague street. I worked on the first UK release of Faust, and I remember when it opened, quite a few people had trouble processing all this, but puppetry is also a core ingredient in Schwenkmayr's work, as is the juxtaposition of wildly incongruous material. A huge amount of Schwenkmayr's work is essentially collage-based, whether expressed through the more conventional form of cut-out images glued onto paper, or the way he utilises existing objects as building blocks to construct the images in his films, which are then edited in such a way as to find unexpected analogies between outwardly dissimilar materials. This is how Schwenkmayr himself puts his philosophy. Analogy is crucial to understanding his work, and he's discussed the subject a great many times, and this sums up his views. Our rationalist civilization is based on an identical principle of thought. Analogy is characteristic for primitive cultures and, of course, for small children, because through analogy, they can broaden their horizon of knowledge, and only thanks to this can they form their concept of the world, which has been typical of man since time immemorial. Man wants, always and under any circumstances, to know the answers to all questions, to live in a concept. Through analogy, a child adds other things and objects to what it already knows, i.e. what it can name, which are similar to each other by some element of its existence. And so, on a certain level of knowledge, they are put into one analogical bag: thunder, drum, cannon, or penis, worm, snake, fish. This knowledge, of course, does not disappear with the rationalisation of one's later years. It is just pushed into the subconscious from where it operates further, forged into a symbol or poetic image. And that statement also makes it clear that one of the highest compliments Schwenkmayr can pay is infantile. Like Picasso, he envies the child's ability to think out of the box because the box has yet to be constructed. And so the child is not only free to experiment, but is actively encouraged to do so. And one of the reasons Schwenkmayr consistently refuses to supply ready-made interpretations of his work is because he wants us to draw our own analogies, to throw our own perception and experience into the mix. Now, collage in some form has been around for hundreds of years, but it was in the early 20th century that the medium really flourished, largely thanks to the Cubists in the 1910s onwards, it's Picasso, and later and more intensively, the Surrealists in the 1920s. And by the middle of that same decade, Sergei Eisenstein, Vsevolod Pudovkin, and other Soviet pioneers were developing and refining their approach to editing film along principles very similar to those practiced by collage artists, in that they sought to combine often wildly disparate images to create specific effects. And of course, all these had a distinguished predecessor in the form of Italian mannerist painter Giuseppe Archimboldo. This is his famous self-portrait, whose human heads, constructed from flowers, fish, books, and many, many other things, are clearly constructed according to the principles of collage, even though the medium is oil on canvas. Archimboldo was the court painter to the eccentric Prague-based Bohemian emperor Rudolf II, who was around in at the turn of the 16th, 17th centuries. And Schwenkmayr has confessed on many occasions that he is absolutely obsessed with his work. As he puts it, "What is it? What attracts me so irresistibly to Giuseppe Archimboldo's method that sometimes I am not even shy of imitation, which I otherwise despise? What sort of force is it which always deafens all rational arguments against it? Is it the evocative force of mannerist Prague to which someone who has lived there all his life succumbs with intense pleasure? Is it the message of Rudolf II himself, secretly crossing the centuries? Or is it a sublimation of memories of childhood masturbation, which psychoanalysts say later manifests itself as a passion for collecting, the accumulation of objects, which is so particular to Archimboldo's method? Did Archimboldo ever masturbate in childhood? We shall obviously never know." Surrealist collage, Soviet montage, and Archimboldo's paintings were both formative and continuing influences on Jan Schwenkmayr, and it comes as little surprise that by the late 60s, when his stylistic approach and thematic preoccupations had become well established, that he found common cause with the Czechoslovak Surrealist group. After many discussions with its ideological guru, Vratislav Effenberger, Schwenkmayr and his wife, Eva, who was also a distinguished surrealist painter in her own right, formally joined in 1970, and he remains an active member to this day. 2 years later, in 1972, he began his most ambitious collage project, the so-called Schwenkmayr's Bilder Lexicon, or Schwenkmayr Encyclopedia. As he put it, I wanted to create an encyclopedia of a kind of alternative world. I started mapping its fictitious flora and fauna. I thought up an equivalent technology and architecture, history and cartography. I took old lexicons, price catalogues and atlases and started cutting them up and sticking them together. After 2 years of work, the project was left as a torso because I came to realise that it would take me all my life.